people say.
The small things, God can do all things. Yeah. You're a man of your word, yeah. All things are possible.
All right, test, test.
When we believe.
I think it's 7 o'clock, y'all. Y'all ready? Let's get ready. Let's get ready to roll. All right. Well, God bless to everybody. Thank the Lord for those who are coming in on the live stream. Bless you tonight. It's Tuesday night. This is the day that the Lord has made. Amen. We are rejoicing and being glad in this day. All right. Nine weeks of a Tuesday night. But tonight, everybody stand. Let's welcome our speaker tonight. Please, put your hands together. Y'all all know who it is. Minister Lloyd Bodo, y'all. Let's give him a hand clap as he comes.
I don't know if I got the preach yet. I'm working on that. I'm working on the preach. I'm about the hoop. I ain't here quite yet. It's coming, though. Sorry, audio, I'm moving around on you up here. So can we give Jesus a hand clap? Come on. Amen. 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 I am excited, y'all. I really am. I was trying to fix the clock back there. It's about 5 minutes off, but I was like, Christina was back there, and she saw me, and I twitched it, and it said like 10:20 or something. I said, oh, Lord, let me turn that back. I'll be lost. I'm a little nervous, so I got to make sure that the time is right. So good evening, World Deliverance Outreach Ministries. Hallelujah. Yes, yes. As Bishop has already introduced, I am Lloyd Bodle, and I greet you in the name of Jesus. I would also like to honor the shepherd of our house, my spiritual father, Bishop Dr. Chris Holmes, and right on time, his lovely wife, Lady Trey Holmes. Bishop, I want to thank you for this opportunity. I don't take it lightly, and I want to also give a special thanks to my good thing, Carmen Bodle, for always supporting me. And she loves me when I'm not even lovable. I know it's hard to believe that I'm not lovable sometimes, but I am not. So I love you, Carmen. Thank you. So this is our Tuesday night Bible study. For those of you here in the sanctuary, we want to thank you for coming out. And those watching online from all over the country and actually all over the world on Facebook and YouTube, we welcome you too. We encourage your engagement and look forward to your comments in the chat. I believe, what's going on there? I bless you in the name of Jesus. And I pray that tonight's word actually stirs something up on the inside of you like it did me when I was preparing. And it's transformative to your life. For anybody that's gotten up here and done what I'm about to do tonight and teach God's word, and you know that there's an attack coming. Lord, help me. So I told Bishop, I said, you know, you got one thing you think you're going to talk about, right? And then the night before, the enemy creeps in. Somehow, some way, he can use a lot of different things. He tries to come in and discourage you. But you know what? He attacked my mind, so I knew I needed to talk about mind and where our minds are. So take out pen and paper, and as my spiritual father said, let's go to work. And as we get started here, y'all, just pray for me. Again, I said I'm a little bit nervous, and I hope I always am a little bit nervous. And I hope that I never take this lightly and take it for granted. I am honored to be in front of you tonight. So the title of my message tonight comes in the form of a question. And it's, where are your thoughts taking you? I'm going to say that one more time. Where are your thoughts taking you? So by a show of hands, who in the room uses GPS in their car to get anywhere they're going? Amen. I know I've been in Arizona, I think it'll be 9 years, and I still put my GPS on everywhere I go. And part of it is that I like to race the GPS, if I'm being honest. I like to cut a couple minutes off. But anyway, so that's most of us here. We use our GPS. But before we can, GPS can start taking us on our journey, you have to give it some information, right? You got to give it some information. It has to know our current location, where we want to go. Amen. I heard that in the back. Where we want to go. And then, I use a particular app. I don't want to give them any shout outs because they're not paying me yet. But if you're advanced, you can actually put in what time. Like if I wanted to get here at 7 o'clock, I would know what time I needed to leave my house or leave the location I was at, right? So I could get there on time. I want to submit to you that our human mind works much like a GPS in our life. We have to give it information too, right? Amen. We supply it in information in the form of what we see, what we hear, what we say, what we think. And the information we give it determines the direction that our life goes. Right. And I thought about this. This kind of came to me as I was in the shower. And have you ever back to that one app that I use a lot for my own GPS. It has a history. So sometimes we can hit history, and it'll take you to a place you've already been before. You said it, Minister Donna. Uh-oh. Sometimes that can be bad if that's not a good place for you to go. Amen. So our minds are the same thing. We can recall, and we can just keep doing the same things over and over. And again, we get caught in those cycles. And I also want to submit to you something that our minds pull our life in the direction of our strongest thoughts. So our strongest thoughts, what are you thinking about the most? What are you that intense about? What are you that intentional about? And our thoughts, they become our words. Our words become our actions. Our actions become our lifestyle. It's how we live, the things we're doing all the time. So audio, if you have it in the back, we're going to look at Proverbs 23, 6 and 7. And I'm in the New King James, whatever version you have. I also saw this really cool video the other day of a pastor. I don't know where he was from, but he had his Bible and he was preaching out of his Bible. And he talked about we leave home. We don't have our phone. What are you doing? Redirect. I'm turning around and hitting that GPS, right? But if we leave home without our Bible, we're okay. Well, we're good. Now, a lot of us have electronic Bibles, so I'm not against that. But I thought it was kind of funny because we sit there and we scroll on our phones. We go through Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, whatever it is. We're looking through it. We're just scrolling. But we don't do that with our Bible as much as we should. Amen. So Proverbs 23, 6. In 7 out of the New King James, verse 6 says, "Do not eat the bread of a miser, nor desire his delicacies." Verse 7, "For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you." Whew. So we all know that the heart, the writer of Proverbs is referring to, is not the red muscle in our chest that pumps blood, right? It's talking about our subconscious mind or our auto programming. What is our default state? That's our heart. And have you ever shot out a text message and you couldn't recall it quick enough, but autocorrect got you? But see, autocorrect works off of artificial intelligence, off what you've been sending out. So sometimes maybe you're sending out some things you shouldn't be sending out. Just saying. I'm just saying. It's not going to just come out of this clear blue sky. So we got, like, in the, I don't know, I can't remember exactly who said it, but we got to be more careful. So I talked to Brother Dwayne on the way here and made sure that he was okay that I use him to kind of illustrate this scripture. So go back to verse 6 real quick, please, audio. It says, do not eat the bread of a miser, nor his delicacies. Verse 7. For as he thinks in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. So let's say Brother Dwayne's got some, he's got a big old slab of wild-caught sockeye salmon. Yeah, he's got it on the grill. Can you see it? I've been fasting all day. I can taste it. And I'm just, but let's say he's got that going on. And I just, a steak, ribeye, whatever it is, right? And all of a sudden, doong, doong, he doesn't know I'm coming. I just swing by. Brother ain't got time to put the salmon away. And I said, oh, man, can I have some of that? And he's like, sure, brother. Let me get you a piece. But you know what he really wants to say? If he's not right with God, he wants to open the silverware drawer, give you the can opener, and say, get a can of tuna out of the pantry. If his heart's not right, because he ain't trying to give his best. He's a miser. You're not a miser. He's a very generous brother, but I'm just saying, for the illustration of this scripture. So we got to make sure that our hearts are right, right? So, amen. Thank you for that one hand clap in the back. but amen, amen. So let's go to the next scripture audio, Matthew 12, verse 34 and 35 out of the New King James. This is in red, so we know that our King Jesus is, this is him. And he says, brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things? We find a way, don't we? Sometimes. For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. So remember what I said. The heart is not the muscle in your chest that pumps blood throughout your body. It's your subconscious mind. How do you normally respond to things? How do you normally operate? What's your modus operandi, if you will? So as a reminder, our thoughts become our words become our actions, and our actions become our lifestyle. You know, like a great man of God says often, we've all heard it, what's in you will come out of you. If they cuss around you and say it slipped, it didn't slip. They're just showing you what they're listening to, thinking about, or hearing on a regular basis. It's what's in them. It's coming out. It's just coming out. You know, but the thing about it is that some people have been able to develop the mental capacity to control themselves for a little while. Let's just say, and we're not picking on World Deliverance. Any church, America, they can handle themselves between 9 and 11 on Sunday morning, 10 and 2, whatever your service time is. But they can control themselves, but eventually it's going to come out. Eventually it's going to come out. And I, you know, if you want good things to come out, we got to put good things in. Amen. Amen. So there's a saying that I've heard, garbage in, garbage out. So if we're putting garbage in, garbage is going to come out. Now we know, I mean, I'm not up here to beat anybody up, but there's just stuff all over television. There's music, there's different, you know, dress, the way people are dressing these days, sometimes you can't tell the difference, you know, and you, no wonder they're confused which bathroom to go in, right? But, you know, now that is real, you know, and we got to put good things in. Amen. So what should we be putting in our minds then? Now, listen, remember, where are our thoughts taking us? What direction is your life going? And I think if we were all being honest, that our life isn't exactly where we'd like it to be. Some of us have a good life. Some of us not, right? Some of us are going down. You know, there's different trajectories in this room here. But if we want our life to change, our mind has to change, and we got to change the things we're putting in it. It has to. You can sit here, listen, we can sit here and listen to this man of God preach and sweat through his suit, you know, whatever, and just walk out of here and our mind, nothing's changed. Nothing's changed. Amen. So let's go to Philippians 4, 8 and 9. Again, we're in the New King James. And remember, the question is, what should we be putting in our minds? Verse 8, finally. He said, finally. Brethren. So he must have been dealing with this for a while if he said finally, right? He said, that's it. Done. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue and there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. Now, what is meditation? It's not downward dog and all that. Meditation is thinking about it over and over and over again, right? Right? So what are you meditating on? Are you meditating on these things that he's talking about, these pure things, these praiseworthy things? Or are we scrolling, meditating on what, you know, what's happening in the world, right? And then you're comparing, we're comparing ourselves and we're wondering why we're depressed, why, you know, the suicide rates are up, all of those things. We're not putting the right things in our mind. And verse 9 says, the things which you learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. So we have great, you know, I love my pastor, so I'm gonna keep doing it. But we have a great example. Amen. So Paul was talking, you know, to the church at Philippi, and he was saying, do the things that I do. Right? Now we're gonna call Paul out here in a minute, so. He wasn't perfect. So we should meditate on truth. Now I have a thing. Anybody that spent any time with me know that something can be true today at, I believe it's 7:18. Thank you, Christina. Now my timekeeper. Amen. She said, I'm ready to go, Brother Lloyd. But but something can be true. But today, but tomorrow may not be. So it's not truth. Come on now. God's word never changes. God never changes. So that's truth. That's what we should be thinking on. That's what we should be meditating on, is truth in his word. Now, what is truth? That's right. The word of God. Our thinking takes us the wrong road or direction when we believe the lies of the enemy. John 8 and 44, and I didn't give audio this because I'm just going to kind of paraphrase, but John 8, 44 says, Satan is the father of lies. Now, I love the Spirit of God because he gave me this when I was studying, and Bishop just talked about this on Sunday when he talked about the roles of a father, right? So if Satan's the father of lies, right? Another word for father is Abba. Abba translated means what? Source. Anybody remember that? So he's the source of all lies. Not just the guy in your ear, but he's the source of every lie you see. Everything that is not of God, that is from Satan. He is the source of that. Amen? So I would ask you, if you got a source that we know is contaminated, would you say that the devil's, the lies he's telling you contaminates our mind, is not pure, right? So If you went to go get a drink of water and the water was brown coming out of the spigot and it was contaminated, would you drink it? Why not? You get sick. It jack your life up, right? You might be spending some time, you know, in the bathroom, right? But, you know, the problem is though, we wouldn't keep drinking the water. But we keep drinking the Kool-Aid of the devil. We keep drinking his Kool-Aid. That ain't even in my notes. That Holy Ghost God, that came on me. Huh? Thank you, Lord. So we got to start drinking from the source of living water, and that's Jesus, right? Right? Amen. 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 That's a good place. That's a good place to praise God, because I need a drink of water. Amen. I'm learning, Bishop. Bishop gives me pointers. Amen. That's right. Lay off the Kool-Aid. All that sugar in the bottom anyway. You didn't even stir it up. Lord. So we know that the enemy, Satan, he's the father of lies, right? In Numbers 23 and 19, though, the Bible says that God is not a man that he should lie. He can't. He can't. So if he can't lie, that makes every word in the Bible the truth and therefore should be the source of our thoughts, right? Why is it not? Are we too rushed, too hurried? Do we have our programming? Oh, I got to run out the door. I got to rush to do this. I got to rush to do that. Oh, I got to take care of this. Bing, notifications on our phone. What is it, you know? There's a lot of those things are probably true for some of us. Excuse me. Now, however, we do all, we're all in different places in our walk with the Lord. Excuse me. If we're being honest, I think that some of us means me, you, some of us, still are believing the lies of the enemy. And it's built strongholds that can be difficult, but not impossible to overcome. So let's go to 2 Corinthians 10. Verses 3 through 7, and again, I am reading from the New King James, because my tongue, just the THs sometimes just gets me, if I'm being honest. So verse 3, for though we walk, in other words, we live in the flesh, which is a body, we do not war, we don't fight according to the flesh or human standards. So we're not fighting one another, y'all. Let's just get that straight. We're not fighting one another. Even if, here we go, Sandy, I'm going to use it. I knew it was going to come up. Brother Flip Flop and Sister Yay Yay may have offended you in church. I was waiting to use that. But it's not. Brother Flip Flop, boy, I tell you, we got to get him right. He got six toes. But you may get offended by something, but it's not them. It's something working inside of them. We just went through 9 weeks on deliverance. We know that there's something in there that just isn't quite of God. So verse 4, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They're not carnal. That ain't you and me. But mighty in God for pulling down. Now I'm going to go back, pulling down, go back real. Pulling down strongholds. So pulling down, we want to demolish those strongholds. And I want to submit to you a definition of strongholds: walls of resistance in people's minds. So we put up these walls. We put up a fortress as a stronghold as well. We're building up this fort, and it's we think it's protecting us from being hurt, but it's not. It's alienating you. It's, you know, you're getting isolated. Next thing you know, you're up in here. All the time. Verse 5, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. The knowledge of God. Now, I tried to find it. I couldn't, but it sounds good. Can I just say it? I don't. Knowledge. It's nothing about. But knowledge, if you think about it, no ledge. I stand on a ledge. I stand on what I know of God. I don't know. That makes sense to me, though. Made sense to me in my mind. we're bringing everything, every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought. Here's some questions to ask yourself. Is it of God? Is it of God? Is it in His Word? If so, keep it, meditate on it, and act on it. If it's not of God, I got the R word. Y'all ready? Repent. Change your thinking. Change. That's the R word. We're going to go there. Come on now. To the Change our thinking to the obedience of Christ in verse 6 and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. My God, God's word is so good. Strongholds can only be fortresses that the enemy has set up in your mind. How do they get set up in your mind? So imagine, I'm walking back and forth on this platform. And y'all leave tonight, come back Sunday, and I'm still doing it. Come back Tuesday, I'm still doing it. I'm doing that for 10, 20, 30 years. What's going to happen to this carpet? Worn out. And you're going to be able to see what? Where I walked. A pathway where I walked. Eventually, carpet's probably going to wear out. The wood's going to might get weak. We might have the new church built around me. No, I'm just kidding. Hey, man, that just came to me too. The Holy Ghost, boy, he's funny, man. He is so funny. So there would be a pathway in the carpet. Then when others saw the pathway, they may think that that's where we should walk. But it might be dangerous there. It might be dangerous because we've been walking in the same place, stagnant, not growing. Come on. My God. Now, let's relate that to our thought life. If we have believed the lies of the enemy and think one way for 10, 20, 30, 40 years, we make neural pathways in our mind, not to get all scientific, but we make neural pathways or tracks that our thoughts travel on. Then a good thought comes in to our mind, but the neural pathway has set up a fortress of negativity. And the positive thought doesn't have a chance initially. So we got a negative mindset, a new thought. We've been thinking that way for a long time. And Brother Yeye brings a great idea to Bishop. Bishop said, nah, we've always done it this way. Brother Lloyd, I want to try this. Nah, we've always done it. That ain't the way we do it around here. Right? But it might be a good idea. Right? Never know. Now, remember, I talked about the negative thought or the positive thought doesn't have a chance initially. However, with the same repetition that wore the path in the carpet, with the negative thoughts, we can start new pathways by using the truth of God's word to destroy the old strongholds. You know, and this can be, you know, frustrating, maybe even confusing at first, because you're like, what's going on here? When we don't see a change in our life. But Pastor Abram, shout out to you. We keep fighting the good fight of faith. Amen. And we stay in his word. Now, remember we talked about Paul and how good he was teaching earlier to the church of Philippi? Well, Paul didn't have an easy time overcoming himself either. Come on. Amen. Let's audio if we can go to Romans 7, verses 15 through 20. Everybody there, say amen. Amen. If not, it's on the screen. For what am I, or what I am doing, I do not understand. Paul, like, what in the world is going on? What happened? Why'd I do that? None of us have ever said that, though, right? We've never done it. Well, I can't believe I did that, right? For what I will to do. Now, this is a tongue. This is, you know, that verse. For what I will to do, that I do not practice, but what I hate, that I do. Lord, help us. If then I do what I will not to do, I agree with the law that is good. But now it is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. So those thoughts keep going over and over and over again, could become sin. Verse 18, for I know that in me, that is in his flesh, nothing good dwells. For to will is present with me, but how to perform what is good I do not find. For the good that I will to do, I do not do. But the evil I will not to do, that I practice. My Lord. Paul, he wasn't confused when he was writing this because he kept it straight. But now if I do what I will not to do. It is no longer I who do it, but sin that dwells in me. So he said it twice now. So he knows that he keeps thinking on these things. He keeps doing these things. Now it's sin. Now he's living a sinful life. Now he's away from God. Come on. So I'm going to tell a story. I'm going to tell it myself. I grew up, we'll just say humble beginnings. He's tearing the food stamps out of the books, y'all, out of the books. And when those came out, like, mom would go shopping, and we'd be stocked up. We had donuts, Apple Jacks, honeycomb. We had all the sweet stuff, right? Right? And anyway, so it developed this pattern in my life that I love sweet stuff. And I can't eat just, I know Lay's has got this trademark, but I can't eat just one donut. I can't just eat one piece of cake. I just can't. So those, all those thoughts of like, oh my gosh, are we going to have it again? We got to wait till the first of the month again to get it. Oh, maybe we can go. Nah, I ain't gonna say that on camera. But you know, now I know some of y'all can relate to maybe smashing a whole pint of Ben and Jerry's ice cream one sitting. What's it say on there? It says three servings. Come on, three servings. That's one serving. Or maybe even, and I'll tell him myself again, driving home from Bible study, eating a four-piece box combo from Cane's on the way home. Okay. And trying not to get the sauce on me. Right? But you know what? I don't need to be eating that late at night. But my mind is fixed on it. I'm hungry. I'm telling myself I'm hungry because I don't have my flesh under control. Right? The soul is supposed to be the bridge between the flesh and the spirit. It's supposed to be controlling that flesh. But if I'm thinking on it, and then, you know, you drive by and you smell it, you're like, Lord, I know Lady T doesn't like Cane's, but I know. It's good, right? But, you know, but when I eat a healthy dinner before Bible study, my body's nourished. I'm no longer a slave to my hunger. Then, and only then, my mind does not drag me in the direction of Cane's, right? Amen? Amen? So I can avoid it. I don't even have to go over there. So I'm almost done, y'all. So I'm running out of material. I'm on my closing. So amen. We'll take some questions from the audience. No, I'm just kidding. So in closing, let's take a look at Romans 12, 1 and 2, again in the New King James. Give y'all a second to get there. I hear some pages actually turning. Amen. That's a good sound. All right. Romans 12, 1 and 2. If you're there, say amen. Verses 1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Now, let's go back to my Cane story. Listen, real talk, overeating is a sin. Gluttony is a sin. So we got to learn to control some of these urges that we have. And our bodies are the temple. We learned about that. Bishop taught 9 weeks on deliverance. And one of the things talking about the temple and all the rooms, and we're the temple of the Holy Spirit. So that's our reasonable service, which means that's the least you should do, right? Verse 2, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So we know it's not God's will for us to be unhealthy. You know, it's not God's will for us to drink too much alcohol at all. I don't drink anything. Smoking, any of that stuff is not God's will. We got to learn to take care of our bodies. Health is one of my things that I'm really passionate about. And recently I went on vacation and kind of lost my mind on vacation, and then just haven't found it yet about getting my eating under control. So, you know, and you go to places like Puerto Rico and things like that, you know, you can kind of get out of control. So in my closing, you know, how do we change our thinking and change the direction of our lives? How do we do that? How about if we did a thought audit? We got some corporate people in here that have done audits, right? Doing audits, you're checking and making sure things, what's there? What's not there? What's missing? Oh. And she's, how long has it been there? Come on now, got to go. We got to go. First in, first out, LIFO, last in, first out, all the accountants in the house. So is it negative or positive? Those are kind of barometers to measure it by. Is it worldly or eternal? Are we feeding our flesh? Are we like, oh my gosh, I gotta buy another pair of sneakers? I know, coming down your street, Crystal. You know, so we got to think about these things. Where is our mind at? Is it on worldly things or the things of eternity? You know, we should be focused on winning souls, getting in the Word, knowing the Word. Another thing too, as part of our thought audit, when we get up in the morning, are we worried? First thing in the morning, are we worried or are we at peace? Amen. Amen. Let's pray for peace. Amen. We don't want to get up worried. That's not a good place. That's not a good starting point. Amen. Amen. And that's why I want to encourage y'all. I wasn't going to say this. Again, 5 a.m. We're praying, y'all. And we're getting breakthroughs. So just, it's out there. Amen. Second thing you can do. First thing is do a thought audit. Second thing is identify the stronghold or lie the enemy is telling us. Now, you know, he's always in your ear. He's always trying to get you, especially I always tell you, you're not going to have a head-on collision with the devil if you're running in the same direction he's going. But he's always trying to get in our ear and whisper these little things. You know, the movies with the devil on one shoulder and the angel on the other shoulder. So he's always trying to whisper in our ear. The third thing, let's read the Word of God and replace the lie that he told us. What God has to say about the matter. Are we seeking after God for answers? Are we seeking his Word? For anybody that doesn't know, there's so many great resources out there. You can search the Bible by topic. So if you're having an issue with depression or lust or whatever it is, there's scripture that you can find scripture on that. Just search out that topic. So replace that lie that the enemy's telling you that woman, oh, she likes you, oh, she smiled at you, you know, she put extra whipped cream on your coffee, whatever it is. That's a lie. That's a lie. So replace it with God's Word. Number four, speak the Word of God over our lives and call those things that be not as though they are. Amen. So we can change the trajectory of our own life by what we're speaking over. If we're speaking negative thoughts, why would you speak negative? Listen, I don't know. We got about 18, 23 people in here, something like that. There's enough people that are going to speak negative about you. Don't speak it about yourself. Come on. I love me some Lloyd. I know that. I do. And not in an arrogant way, but I love who God created me to be. Amen. Number four is speak the Word of God over our lives and call those things that be not as though they are. Number five, be accountable to someone. And listen, for the married folks, or about to be married folks, if there's some things you're dealing with that you need someone, an outside perspective on, get that person. Find that person, someone you can trust. I always tell it, somebody that can hold water. I don't want to put water in them. Next thing you know, they're telling my business all the way around the block. And I walk to the store. I'm like, oh, Lord, everybody looking at me funny and, you know, everything else. So you want to have somebody that you can trust. And find yourself a prayer partner. And husbands, pray with your wife. Men of God, find a man you can pray with and that you can, you know, he'll uplift you. He'll speak life into you when you're not where you need to be. And you can do the same thing to him. So that's a two-way street. Amen. And here's the last one. And I'm not big on cutting off necessarily, because I never wanted Jesus to cut me off. But you do sometimes have to shrink your circle of influence. You know, amen. There's too many opinions, too many agendas, all of those things. Am I talking to you, Blue? Amen. So, you know, we got to be careful how many people are in that close circle. You know, there's different levels of relationships that we should be having. Not everybody gets all the way in, right? But in closing, you know, I pray that this helps somebody tonight and, you know, causes you just to be a stimulus to dig into God's word and find out what he says about you, and believe those things because they're true. Everything he says about you is true, and he loves you. The enemy does not love you. He hates you. The enemy hates you. Exactly. He hates you. Let's build the kingdom of God. Let's love one another. Let's get our minds right, get our thinking right. Not everybody's against you. Not everybody's trying to take you down. Don't even give that all that energy. You're giving it too much. You're giving it too much. I tell people like this, and I think I said it Thursday night about we got a bunch of hot men on the call, and everybody's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. Humble, open, and transparent. And that's the way I live my life. So what if I tell you something, you can't use it against me because I've already given it to God, for one. He's got it covered by the blood of Jesus. So there's nothing you can do. You can try, but you're going to be spinning your wheels. So thank you for your time tonight. God bless you. I love you all.
Amen. That was good. Wonderful, wonderful word. Now, Ms. Lloyd, let me make sure I got that title right. It was, "Where Are Your Thoughts Taking You?" That's what I thought. Okay. I got a question. You stay up here if you want. I was thinking about this. Thank God for all y'all that's commenting on here. Where are your thoughts taking you? Just that in itself is something to really think about. Because that's saying that my thoughts take me to a destiny. Isn't that amazing? That your thoughts can dictate where you end up. Your thoughts. And if I understand that my thoughts can take me sometimes places I don't want to go, why would I not change my thinking? Has anybody in this church ended up in a place where you said, how in the world did I get here? See, there are two different types of people, and I'm gonna be real with y'all on this. There are followers, and there are leaders. Do you know what the biggest difference is between somebody who follows and somebody who leads? They're thinking. The enemy is so crafty that he wants to keep your life so convoluted that you don't have time to think. You know how people get ideas? Through thoughts. That's how powerful this mind is. And there are some things that you have to really teach yourself to get into a place where you can begin to think on. Why do you think in the word it says, think on these things? Because there's a whole lot of stuff you can think on. God said, think on things that's going to take you in the right direction. Amen. The other thought I have with this, and I'm gonna turn it loose, is where you wanna go. Where are you trying to go? Again, another difference between leaders and followers. And there are a lot of people who act like they're leaders, but really are not. There's some things I'm really good at, and some things I'm not. They ask me every Sunday, where you want to go? Yeah, I don't know. And some people you ask, they right away. I want this, I want that. See, my thinking is on such another. I don't spend all my time thinking about food. So when I get asked that stuff, you can tell it's not at the forefront of my thoughts. I got bigger fish to fry. Isn't that amazing? The food analogy, right? But think about it. So a man thinketh, continually thinks, which really kind of goes into what you're talking about, meditation, right? So a man thinketh, where? What does the scripture say? When he thinketh in his heart, what does it say next? So is he. Not only do your thoughts dictate where you go, but your thoughts dictate who you become. Wow. Sometimes we wonder, how did I get here? How did I get to be in this place that I'm at right now? How did I become who I am? Your thoughts. And here's the best part about it. If you want to change where you are, you want to change who you are, change your thinking. So what's the good news with that? You don't have to stay. Did y'all hear what I said? As long as there's breath in your body, I don't care how old you are, I don't care how young you are, if you change your thinking, you will change your destination. And that's the best part of this recap, is where I am right now, not where I'm going. I can change it. If I don't like the trajectory of where my life is, guess what? I can change it. You know what I found out about most people, Minister Lloyd? They don't want to change. That's the truth, Minister Donna. And for a lot of people, they are comfortable right where they are. Yeah. Look at that. See, this is why I love when you follow the leading of the Holy Spirit. Because somebody put in the chat today, Victoria, thank you for typing this in. She said, Minister Lloyd, I was meditating on that scripture today while I was working. Hallelujah. See? So it is a confirmation. But that's what I wanted every person in this room to get tonight. You can change. You can change. At any point, you can change. I don't have to stay where I am. I don't have to stay in the situation I'm in. If I want change bad enough, change this. So a man thinketh. Listen, this is the last thing I say, and then we're going to get offering. So a man thinketh, ETH, continually thinks in his. Your mind is the gate to your heart. So the enemy knows if I want you to produce something, I got to get it in your head first before it gets in your heart. Because once I get you thinking on it, you know what you're doing? Sowing the seeds. Isn't that powerful? It's such a powerful concept because listen what Joshua says. Joshua 1 and 8. No, he says, meditate on the word day and night. The word, people of God, is seed. Why would Joshua tell you to meditate on the word day and night? Because he's telling you, get the seed in you. See? When you meditate on the word day and night, what happens is it starts to get in you. Then he says, now you take the next step and you begin to observe and do what the word says. He says, then you make your way. Now this revelation just hit me. How do you make your way prosperous and have good success? Because when you meditate on the word, guess what? It gives you the direction. You don't have to guess where I'm supposed to be going. So when I asked the question earlier, where do you want to go? Most people can't answer because they haven't been given the direction. No, I'm telling you, this stuff is downloading to me right now. That's why, again, the word says the steps of who, a righteous, not just any man, a righteous man, right standings with God and in right position with God. The steps of a righteous man are ordered, which means God's already got it planned. So God said, you got to align your thinking. Romans 12, 1 and 2, align your thinking with my plan, with my truth, my direction, and you will end up prospering and having good success. There's no shortcuts to it. No shortcuts. But one of the biggest issues that you will have in life is fighting complacency. Me and DeForest was talking at the bowling alley last night, right? DeForest showed me his resume. And I was thinking to myself, there you go, man of God. Change some stuff. I mean, you're not too old to change. How many people say, I can't stand my job? Why are you still there? I just don't like it. I don't like my boss. I don't like my hours. Why are you complaining? Get out. Let's see how that, you see, we say this stuff and we even think this stuff, but we don't change it. And the answer is what? The question is why? Because it's going to take something that's going to push me outside of my comfort zone. But that was encouraging to see that. Hey, I'm redoing my resume because I want something different. And something that's going to pay me more. You see? That's the start of your transformation. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I keep saying I'm in with that, but I am. Seriously, I'm in with it. See, Minister Lord, you got me going. Stuff just coming in now. Say this last thing one more time. I got three, right? Last thing. When something gets birthed in me, from my thinking to my heart, and it starts producing in you, now watch the next step. Says, out of the abundance of my heart, what starts speaking? My mouth. Why is that important? Come on. Think, church. Because there are only some things that will manifest when I say it. God is the word. The word is God. In other words, God was so full of the word that when he spoke something, which was the word, whatever you are full of, whatever comes out of you is a product of what's in you. So when he spoke it, guess what came out of him? What came out of him, what was in him, and then it created it. And if I'm in his image and in his likeness, here's the key. When I get full of it, out of the abundance, when my mouth speaks, what is it supposed to do? Create. It's supposed to create. It's supposed to change things. And see, this is why, again, the devil don't want you thinking on good things. He don't want you meditating on the word. Are you kidding me? Because if you keep doing that, you're going to get full of it. And guess what's going to start coming out your mouth? Faith. Are y'all listening to me? Now, when faith stuff starts coming out, oh, man, it's over. Because as kings in the earth, we're supposed to declare. We're supposed to decree. And when a king declares, and when a king decrees, guess what? It's over. It's done. You create what you see that. So again, this is the next step of faith in all of this. Change your thinking so you can change your heart and change your speech. And then you start creating things differently around you. How many of y'all got up this morning and said, thank God that today is going to be a day of favor? No, I'm serious. I believe this stuff so much, we practice it. Me and Lady T touch and agree. When we go play, we touch and agree and say, watch the favor of God show up today. Wherever we go today, favor's going to follow us. And then we start testing it. It is. I'm serious. Now, my daughter, Crystal, you remember this. Blue, you remember this. Sunday night, right? What did we get hungry for? No, it was Sunday. Sunday night. I mean, they took me to a nice dinner, you know. And because we got out of church so early, it was like a brunch. And y'all know how we get around 8 o'clock. All the kids was over at around 8 o'clock. We got in the pool and they got out and said, I'm hungry. We hungry. And it was a unanimous decision. We all hungry. So I said, all right, what y'all want? Everybody, Popeye sounds good. So listen, y'all, we jump in the car. We go to Popeye's. Now it's 9:05. We pull up in front of Popeye's and they're closed. The lights are off. And I'm thinking like, that sign on the door say 10 o'clock. So they had a guy in the parking lot and a girl was in the parking lot, probably her boyfriend. They had a little chair in the door, propping the door open. And I walk in and say, it's 9:10. She gave us some excuse. Well, we're short staffed, blah, 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 blah. And I'm thinking like, I'm calling corporate. Me and Chris was like, we calling corporate on y'all. You can't close 45 minutes before. I don't know. I didn't call. Did you call, Krista? You didn't call. All right. We still need to call. We should. It was, I didn't like the answer. So we were hungry for Popeye. So, no, just give me an example. Just your mouth. Well, I said, well, let's go. Where's another one? And they already knew. Alva's, let's go to one on Alva's. So, all right, let's go. We go over there. We get to around the corner. We pull up in front. I'm like, the light's on. This is a good sign. They're still open. So I'm thinking like, there's people in this inside too. Then we get closer. We're like, oh, they're all employees. Oh no. So we get in the drive-thru and we start ordering. The guy says, I don't have enough to do a 16-piece chicken. Like, what? Don't y'all sell chicken? So annoying. So the guy says, okay, I can do 12 pieces. And they screaming from the back, do y'all got any wings? Guy says, I don't know why he even said, we got one wing. They're like, one wing? So finally, I just ask him, all right, what do y'all have? I got a couple chickens. So I said, just put them in there. I told the lady, I told them all, I said, watch the favor of God show up. Am I lying? I said, watch the favor of God show up. So I just start telling the guy, just put it in there. What else y'all got? We got three strawberry biscuits left. Put them in there. y'all got mashed potatoes and gravy? Yeah, I got a couple. Put them in there. I'm doing all this on the speaker, right? Just put them in there. We get it to the window. He didn't even tell us the price, nothing. We get to the window. And I think the guy was just like, whatever. Whatever we got, I'm throwing it into this bag. So we end up getting all that food for, I don't even think we probably got it at like 70% off or something like that. He just charged us one price and just threw a bunch of stuff in there. And then I said, well, favor's working. I might as well keep working it. I said, y'all got some lemonade in them jugs back there? Y'all got sweet tea or something in them jugs? They all looking at me like, here we go, Bishop. There's some testing the favor. So the guy was like, well, we don't have no more jugs. He said, do you want it in the cup? Yeah, give me a cup. So I got lemonade. And we should have kept going, but we ended up because somebody behind us, they didn't get nothing because we got all of it. Was sitting there waiting on us to leave, was probably cussing at us. But the point is this, you can have whatsoever you say. I'm telling you, people of God, test it. create your future. That's why it drives me crazy. When you tell somebody, speak faith, and the first thing they do is, well, this old sickness. I'm like, you didn't hear nothing I just said. Quit saying that stuff. Speak life. Amen. Speak faith and watch God work. All right. God bless you. Thank you, Minister. Boy, for that word. You stirred me up tonight. You stirred me up. All right. Let's sow seed. Thank you, those that are still watching, that you didn't give up on us. And by the way, Minister Bodo, I like canes. How many of y'all like canes? I like canes. Yeah, she do. If she hungry enough, she eat canes. She eat it. She love that Texas toast. I like canes. While y'all getting your seat ready, how many of y'all gonna test this favor stuff out? Test what you see. I'm telling you, the more you do it, the bolder you'll get. And I'm like this. Hey, the Bible said you have not because you what? You ask not. Look, favor is preferential treatment. People start doing stuff for you and don't even know why they doing it. I don't know why I'm doing it. And want to help you, want to bless you. Amen. All right. Ushers. Y'all, they're in the hands of the ushers. Go ahead. All right. Those that's given, you can stand. Everybody else, you can. You probably already have electronically gave using debits, credits. Come on. Lady T, we say it all the time. It's good to have grown kids that still want to be around you. Amen. That's a beautiful thing. When you have grown kids that want to be around you. And I just think that that's a great thing. And we have a good time with our kids. Amen. We have a good time with our kids. And every parent should. Enjoy your children. Amen. All right. Minister Bodo, come on up here. Bless our offering and you can dismiss us. And we out of here.
Amen. All minds clear. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Father, we ask right now that you bless this offering. Father God, you bless those that gave, Father God, those that wanted to, Father God, I ask that you would give them seed, Father, so that they can give next time, Lord. Father, we ask for the 30, 60, or 100-fold, Father God, whatever your will is, Lord God. But we know we're asking for the 100-fold, Father God, to advance the kingdom of God. This monies, Father God, will go into win souls, Father God, to draw people into the name of Jesus, Father God. We want to continue to lift up the name of Jesus. Father, we ask right now that your seed would never have to beg bread, Father God. And we ask right now in the name of Jesus that you bless this offering. Amen. The offering is blessed. You are blessed and you are dismissed. Amen.